So this is where we left off. We left off on diaphragmatic herniation. Not super common. And if you could tell here with this photo, obviously it's a baby, right? So this is considered congenital diaphragmatic herniation. And if you could see what happened in this picture, you can see the intestines actually herniated through the diaphragm up into the chest wall. Now, the problem with that is obviously look how it's pushing all of the mediastinum over to the right side of the patient's chest. Because of that, it's not always infants, right? Adults could have this too. Again, just rare, but these patients are going to be experiencing labored breathing, tachycardia, and a sunken abdomen. Okay, because a lot of those intestines are being pushed up into the chest wall, their abdomen may appear to be concaved. Now, another thing that you might note with this patient is the patient might be experiencing with that trouble breathing. When you listen to lung sounds, you'll hear bowel sounds in the chest. But if we were to treat this patient, you'd have to elevate their head 15 to 30 degrees and provide positive pressure ventilations.
Mike, question with that.
Yo. Yeah, question two.
Can that lead to obstructive shock because it's pushing up against all that mediastinum?
Technically, right? If it's putting up enough pressure, it's the same concept of like tension pneumo. If it's putting pressure, applying pressure to that heart, not allowing it to basically beat. Absolutely.
Since that's congenital, would you notice that at birth? Or can that happen at any time throughout the child's life, even though it's congenital?
Yeah, again, it could happen to adults, right? It could be involved with trauma. There can be different means or reasons for diaphragmatic herniation. So with congenital diaphragmatic herniation, the child's born with it, but the person or patient does not have to be born with it to have this medical condition occur. Good questions. Stroke is one of these medical conditions that is still somewhat of a leading cause of death, medical death, right? Stroke happens in two different forms, right? We have either hemorrhagic stroke or ischemic stroke. And still within this national registry, there's still some sort of like window of where we need to assess the patient, say that this person has a stroke, and it becomes like a time thing. Your textbook still states 3 to 4.5 hours is that window of the beginning of symptoms to when that patient needs to be given fibrinolytic therapy at a stroke center, right? If you remember that we have primary stroke centers and we have comprehensive stroke centers. At comprehensive stroke centers, that patient can get a lot more invasive treatment, and the patient can go under neurosurgery, right? Now, if the patient falls within that window, when their symptoms are less than 3 to 4.5 hours, that patient can get treatment with fibrinolytic clot busters. If the patient is outside that window, they're no longer allowed per national standard to get those clot busters because they have an increased risk of a brain bleed, right? Now this is going to be a lot more protocol driven. I know where I work currently, my window is increased from 4.5 or 3 hours to 24 hours. But again, this is rapidly changing. I've seen those numbers change multiple times in the last decade, but still for national standard wise, it's still 3 to 4.5 hours as of right now. Performing a stroke assessment is going to be different depending on your agency or where you're working. Cincinnati Stroke Scale is still a really popular one. That's the go ahead and lift up your hands, close your eyes. Do you see arm drift? Let me see you smile. All right. Another good one is tell them to elevate their legs. We have weakness in one leg or the other. We could say repeat after me, you can't teach an old dog new tricks, and trying to get to see if that patient has a slur in their speech. So just different methods of looking for facial droopage or weakness on one side. definitely have to get a stroke assessment early on with these types of patients. And then ensure that SpO2 is between 94 and 99. That's literally all we're doing for treatment. There's nothing that we're going to give pre-hospital to a stroke that's going to like fix their situation. This patient needs to go to a stroke hospital or a stroke center, right? Real quick on oxygen therapy. I don't give stroke patients oxygen if they don't need it, period. Why? Because oxygen can act as a vasoconstrictor. And if I give oxygen to just any patient that's having a stroke, I can potentially make the stroke worse. Again, if my patient does not have an SpO2 of less than 94, I am not giving them oxygen, period. All right. Hemorrhagic stroke. Remember, this patient actually has a bleed. Does that mean that that patient could potentially have ICP, intracranial pressure? Absolutely. Okay. Patients with ICP, this is when you're going to be seeing that one pupil blown, maybe both pupils are blown. This patient's going to be altered mental. A lot of the times these patients, they'll have an upward gaze and they won't be able to look in both directions, right? Look for the signs for ICP. Look for head trauma. A lot of the times these patients fall and actually hit their head. It doesn't require that patient to fall and hit their head though to have a hemorrhagic stroke, okay? Again, what are we doing about it? We're trying to maintain that O2 saturation and we're taking them to the proper hospital. Patients with hemorrhagic strokes, do you think that they would require clot busters? No. All right, that's for ischemic strokes. That's for a clot. So look at the signs, look at the symptoms, and we need to take those patients to the appropriate hospitals. Seizures, they come in a lot of different varieties. Remember, this is kind of like a brain attack. We got different firing of neurons all over the place, causing this patient to seize. So there's different types of seizures. First one, focal or partial type of seizures. These patients could have a seizure of just like one part of their body. This is always, to me, one of the weirdest. Well, absent seizures are pretty weird, but focal and partial seizures are like really strange because there'll be a patient and their arm is doing this and they're talking to you. You're like, are we dancing? Like, what's going on here? And the patient's just like, oh yeah, I have seizures, or their leg is moving and they can't stop it. Most of the times these patients, they'll stop on their own. If it gets really bad, we can give a benzodiazepine to help relax them. But partial seizures, they're conscious still. Tonic-clonic, this is what you guys are thinking about in your head. When you hear the word seizure and you look at this photo, this is exactly what you're thinking about. Tonic-clonic seizures. Now, tonic means systemic rigidity. So the patient becomes really stiff. All right. Clonic means intermittent contractions. So the patient's stiff and then contracts, stiff, contracts, and it's just back and forth, and the patient's constantly moving. Sometimes can be like really disturbing, especially to people who've never seen this before. Now, another thing that you might see on your patient is nystagmus. Nystagmus is involuntary eye movement. So even when that patient might stop seizing or during the seizure, you'll see their eyes going back and forth, rapid movement, or you'll see their eyes rolling into the back of their head. This is normal for seizure activity. Absent seizure is, I believe it's a little more common in like little kids, but they literally kind of just lose focus. And sometimes, absent seizures get kind of diagnosed by teachers or people who try to teach the child, because sometimes you'll watch like a little kid playing with their friends and then all of a sudden they just kind of zone out and like stare off into the distance and then they're back, you know, but they don't even realize that it's happening. They keep losing focus. And sometimes it can be longer periods of time where they're like, all right, kids, let's clean up the toys. And the kid's just standing there like staring at the wall. They're like, oh, someone broke Tommy, right? But Tommy's all right. He just has an absent seizure. Status epilepticus. A crazy terminology, kind of like status asthmaticus. Status epilepticus is seizures that last longer than 4 to 5 minutes or reoccur without return of consciousness. So we'll have somebody that drops, they start having a seizure. Maybe this patient is epileptic, so they have history of seizures, they take medication for their seizures. And before they even get into a postictal state and maybe regain consciousness, they seize again. People call 911. Typically, like, usually if somebody has epilepsy, everyone that lives in that house or whoever takes care of that person or just lives with that person, they know it's a seizure. It's not that big of a deal. But if seizures start to last longer than a certain period of time, they have to call 911. Or if reoccurring seizures occur, because you got to remember this patient, a lot of the times they lack oxygen, and these patients can go into rhabdomyolysis. There's a lot of problems with having reoccurring seizures. So how do we stop seizures? Benzos, right? Benzodiazepines are given to stop seizures. Anaphylaxis. So anaphylaxis typically falls into two different groups of patients. We have those with dyspnea and those without. So there's like this chart of anaphylaxis where they say, okay, we got mild symptoms to severe symptoms. Mild to moderate symptoms typically look like what you're looking at here on the screen. This guy in the top right, mild symptoms, right? He's sneezing. Maybe everyone in here has had some sort of history with mild symptoms of an allergy. Start getting into more moderate. You look at this kid up here on the top left, pretty serious urticaria. And then in the bottom ones, we start to see signs of facial swelling, right? And we have an angioedema with the girl on the bottom left here with the swollen lips. So understand that once it starts to get into dyspnea and we start to hear wheezing or diminished lung sounds, and it starts to encroach on that patient's respiratory drive, this is when it starts to become severe anaphylaxis. Okay. Now, how are we treating it? If I have a patient that has mild to moderate, so again, we got our mild to possibly moderate, right? How are we treating that? Starting off with Benadryl. I have no problem treating this patient with Benadryl, right? 25 to 50 milligrams IVIM. I could start giving this patient beta 2 agonist if I hear a little bit light wheeze, things of that sort. But once I start getting into more angioedema and affecting my patient's airway, maybe shortness of breath, now I need to start to really consider early epinephrine. All right. Epinephrine is the best, 100% the best medication for anaphylaxis. Okay. Don't forget your Solumedrol or corticosteroid that we can give to this patient. Again, we could give Atrovent with our Albuterol. And but epinephrine is typically what we want to give to this patient. Hypothermia, obviously, once you go and take your national registry, believe me, you're going to get questions of this patient's in the snow, this patient's in these type of living conditions. I know where you guys live in Florida, you don't have snow. How can we get hypothermia in patients that don't live in the snow?
Cold floor if they're old.
All right. So floors, right? We have, if my patient's laying in on tile, if my patient is just laying on hardwood floors or whatever the case might be for long periods of time, there is a chance that your patient could become hypothermic. That's typically what we do see. Another one is the patient's wet. Could be from sitting out in the rain. Could be the patient fell in the bathtub and during a shower, and now the patient's just soaked, whatever the case might be, we do find patients that are hypothermic. Understand with hypothermia, bradycardia is something that is very common with hypothermic patients. And that's something we need to understand, that their heart rate is slower because of the hypothermia. And these patients need active warming, all right? This is not a cardiac problem. This patient is hypothermic.
I have a quick question.
Yeah, what's up?
So like previous test questions have said like your patient is hypothermic and then it's in V-fib. What should you do? Should you shock them? Should you warm them? Should you withhold medication? Those just always get confusing because realistically, yeah, we don't deal with that here in Florida.
All right. So whenever they pull up the whole cardiac arrest with hypothermia, it's a good question because these are cases that have happened in time where they say, hey man, somebody's cardiac arrest and they're hypothermic. They always say they're not dead until they're warm and dead, right? From hypothermia, because they've gotten people back from severe hypothermia like hours after that patient coded, just because their body has basically been like preserved and with hypothermia. So with that being said, we're going to run the code as if it's any other code, right? Even if it's prolonged downtime, if the patient is hypothermic, there is a chance that you can bring them back. So we're going to run it just like a regular code. If the patient's in a shockable rhythm, we're shocking. All right, let's jump back into endocrine system. We know that endocrine system deals with hormones. The first one that we need to talk about, though, is Addison's disease, Addisonian crisis, right? Addison's disease is adrenal insufficiency. So your adrenal gland, this one up here, you have an insufficiency of the adrenal glands, which, remember, this creates cortisol, right, and aldosterone. So it limits or reduces the amount of cortisol and aldosterone that's being created in the adrenal glands. These patients are going to be very fatigued. They're going to have joint pain, dizziness, weight loss. These patients are going to look anorexic, and they are going to be hyperkalemic. Okay, so let me repeat those signs and symptoms that you could see on a test. Patient could appear fatigued, could have joint pain, dyspnea, they could have rapid weight loss, and they can appear hyperkalemic with Addison's disease. For those of you who don't remember what the treatment for Addison's disease is, it is that hydrocortisone, 100 milligrams of hydrocortisone. Now, next one, myxedema coma. Myxedema coma is kind of like a strange disorder. Sometimes you'll hear it considered adult hypothyroidism. Now, typically with myxedema coma, it's hypothyroidism that involves decrease in mental status, right? Patient is going to become hypothermic, so decreased temperature. Their patient's going to have all their organs are going to start to slow down. I've even heard these patients, they have like a waxy appearance on their skin, right? And they become unresponsive. But that's due to hypothyroidism. Graves' disease, immune disorder that results in hypertrophy of the thyroid, right? The thyroid gland. And because it hypertrophies, it actually causes overproduction, right? So we call it hyperthyroidism. Now, believe it or not, this is 10 times more common in women than it is in men. Graves' disease is. These patients become very diaphoretic, very agitated. They have an increased appetite, but they still have weight loss because their body's like on overdrive. They have a difficult time sleeping. They're always thirsty, but they're constantly dehydrated. They're constantly sweating, diaphoretic, right? And also there's edema that starts to build up in tissue behind their eyes and makes it look like their eyes are popping out of their head. All right. So that's typically what you'll see with Graves' disease. Remember, that's hyperthyroidism. With diabetes, this whole discussion on endocrine can be hours long on its own. With diabetes, we know we have hypoglycemia, right? Hypoglycemia, it's these patients, they your body requires glucose to function, right? Your brain needs it. And if your brain does not get glucose, you will shut down, right? You can't operate. These patients that have typically, it's once they start being below 60. Now, this isn't for everybody. Remember, you have type 1 and type 2 diabetics. Typically, whatever this patient's sugar is normally for them is how they can function. So some people, they'll function in the mid-50s, and that's normal for them. But there's another patient with hypoglycemia, and once they hit 60, they're out unresponsive, or they're going to be very altered. So everyone with diabetes, they kind of have their own homeostasis, and we need to understand that. But these patients, I always say, cool and clammy, need some candy, right? If the patient, you approach them, you hear that snoring respirations, you look at them, they're very diaphoretic. One of the first things that I'm always going to say is check a BGL, right? Let's see what's going on with the sugar. Maybe we can just get a line, give them some D50, D10, whatever you guys are given. As of right now with national standards, D50 is still the preferred treatment for adults. Is it going to stay that way? I don't know. Probably going to change. Why? Because the chance of causing hyperglycemia is there, right? Now, some of these patients have hyperglycemia and they don't care, right? We call this typically diabetic burnout. Some patients, or they just don't take care of themselves very well. Hyperglycemia causes a lot of problems. Typically, patients with hyperglycemia, they feel super exhausted, right? Their body's working on overdrive to get rid of those ketones that they start to build up. Now, how do they get rid of ketones? Frequent urination, polyuria, right? If I ever take a test and I'm reading it, and all of a sudden the term polyuria pops up, it's typically one of two things. It's either going to be hyperglycemia or it's going to be UTI, right? So now I'm looking, is there a fever? Is my patient, remember the three P's, polyuria, polydipsia, and polyphagia. Those are the three P's of hyperglycemia. Just pay attention to what this patient is experiencing in that sort of test question to guide you of what kind of problems that patient's having. Typically for hyperglycemia, the only thing that we'll do for treatment-wise is we'll get a line and provide fluids, right? Ultimately, this patient needs insulin to level out their sugars. Now, the problem with hyperglycemia, these patients, they can live years and years and years with hyperglycemia, and eventually they will have to lose different things in their life. Some of them lose legs, limbs, due to neuropathy. Some of them lose their eyesight. Hyperglycemia will make them lose their kidneys, right? It's actually one of the number one reason for renal failure, hyperglycemia. Strange things here, Wernicke's encephalopathy and Korsakoff syndrome. Two different disorders they actually work together. That you might have read about and just kind of glimpsed over it. Never thought you'd see it again. I've seen this now come up a couple times in different exams that I've looked at and different things. Now, they both deal with thiamine, all right? So if you remember what thiamine is actually a medication that we can give, 100 milligrams of thiamine. It's vitamin B1, right? Vitamin B1. Now, typically we're giving thiamine to patients that we consider thiamine deficient. Now, patients that are typically thiamine deficient are alcoholics. Now, when we talk about Wernicke's encephalopathy, it's a complication of this thiamine B1 inside the patient, and it involves the patient to become confused. It makes them have a unsteady gait, right? The patient can't maintain their own balance and also messes with their ocular function, all right? So Wernicke's encephalopathy occurs in the brain, complication of thiamine, and it has three symptoms. Just reiterating this, confusion, unsteady gait, and ocular dysfunction. Now, if Wernicke's encephalopathy is not treated, right? Patient's not treated with thiamine, right? And then the patients will suffer from something called Korsakoff syndrome, right? With Korsakoff syndrome, the patient goes from confusion to delirium, right? And the patient, it can be like an acute onset of just the patient's all over the place, no idea where they are, what's going on. But they kind of both work hand in hand with regards to thiamine deficiency. Sickle cell crisis. You can see what a normal red blood cell looks like. I always say it looks like an inner tube, right? At a water park. But then you look at what sickle cell, it actually turns into like a sickle. And the problem with sickle cell is that it can go into a blood vessel and create a clot, right? And it can cause joint pain. Sickle cell causes actually a lot of pain to patients that have sickle cell crisis and anemia. Remember, anemia is just these normal red blood cells. If they have sickle cell, they can have shortness of breath and extreme pain. Okay, these patients are typically treated with pain management, analgesics, and fluid therapy. TCAs. All right, tricyclic antidepressants. TCAs are obviously given to patients that have that suffer from depression. And if my patient overdoses on TCAs, they're going to have some interesting symptoms that we need to look out for as responders. All right, first, tachycardia. Patient's going to be tachy. Patient's going to be tachypneic, breathing fast. Hypotension. Hyperthermia. So patients breathing fast, low blood pressure, high temperature, possibly dilated pupils, and altered mental status. Okay. So the patient's going to be confused, dilated pupils, hyperthermia again, tachycardia, and tachypnea. Remember, this TCAs will cause what's known as a sodium potassium blockade. And because of that, there's going to be a cardiac dysrhythmia associated with TCA overdose. Now, that cardiac dysrhythmia that you might look at is going to have prolonged PR intervals and or wide complex tachycardia. So this patient will still have P waves, but you're going to see those QRS a lot wider and looks a little odd with TCA overdose. They can even have prolonged QT intervals. So if you have prolonged QT intervals, you could think of, hey man, this could potentially cause some deadly dysrhythmias if left untreated, okay? If you do see altered EKGs and your patients, and you're suspecting that this patient overdosed on TCAs, we need to treat it with sodium bicarb. Remember, that's 1 milliequivalent per kilogram. So what can we do about TCA overdose? We find this patient with dilated pupils, patients, altered, hyperthermic. We find the INE medication because there's a lot of different TCAs out there. Typically, if I see INE at the as the suffix, I'm already thinking TCA. I usually will try to confirm this either by looking at Google or I'm going to call poison control. And then we can go from there. Just make sure you do your detailed assessment. All right, envenomation. Now, this is something that I know here where we live in Florida is definitely a possibility. Not only snakes, but spider bites, things of that sort. Envenomation is challenging because typically once we get there, do you think that animal's still there? Probably not. So we try to get the best description of whatever bit that person as possible. The best kind of description that we can get. Now, signs and symptoms are going to vary depending on the animal that performed the envenomation. But typically the treatment is usually the same. What are we going to do about it? Wash it. We can use soap and water. All right. We don't put ice packs on it. We're not going to put a tourniquet on it. Nothing like that. We'll wash it, immobilize it, so start a line, and transport the patient. Okay. So again, wash the wound, immobilize the wound, splint it, start a line, and go. All this should be done in transport.
Aren't you supposed to suck the poison out with your mouth?
Only if you have a student with you. You're going to ask the student to suck it out. Okay. But no. Now you got to think too, whenever this person gets bit by whatever they're gotten bit by, it's almost instantaneous that that venom envenomation starts to interact with their body. It starts to move throughout their bloodstream pretty quickly. So I know your textbook probably says try to catch the animal and bring it with you to the hospital. Yeah, no chance. Not happening. Sexual assault, just another thing that unfortunately we have to deal with in EMS, but this is something that is going to be a very challenging call that you might potentially have to run. Patient assessment, we try to have the same sex of the patient perform a patient assessment as best we can. We want to get detailed history, what happened, what's going on, signs and symptoms that this patient's experiencing. But more importantly, we need to protect their privacy and dignity. They're going to have certain requests. We want to try to give them or help them as best we can. One thing that we have to make sure that we do is we preserve evidence. Okay. A lot of the times this patient may want to get rid of clothing or whatever the case might be. We need to try to hold on to anything that we can because it's going to be used as evidence. Trauma. First thing right out the gate, bleeding control. And you know what's interesting, man, is bleeding control has changed over time. It was not uncommon to hear about pressure points, you know, over a decade ago where we used to say, okay, well, if the bleed is coming from the arm, I need to put two fingers and apply pressure to the brachial artery and see if I could slow down the bleed. We don't do that anymore because it was done incorrectly. It wasted time, things of that sort. So what we do now is we apply pressure. Okay. I always tell, especially providers, you guys, use your hands. You guys have gloves on, you show up, apply direct pressure with your hand, get whatever sort of gauze, trauma kit that you have, and then utilize that to apply pressure with dressings, right? If holding direct pressure does not work, we go straight to a tourniquet now. We used to elevate, wait, apply more dressings. More and more research is coming out saying, hey man, direct pressure should stop bleeding. If it does not, apply the tourniquet. If it's been a long time since you've done med calculations, volume times the drip set over time. So for example, that's 500 bag that you see on your screen. If we wanted to give that bag with a 10 drop set over 10 minutes, all we would do is we would say 500 times 10, because that's our drip set, to give us 5,000. Divided by 10 minutes, okay? So that would give us 500. And that's how many drops per minute. So that would be a little extreme to give that over 10 minutes. But that is exactly how we would perform that formula, okay? So volume times drip set over time. I do get asked the question a lot, Mike, man, if I'm taking the National Registry, can I use a calculator? Yes. Yep. There's going to be a button that says calculator. You just click on it and you can use a calculator. Nobody likes math. Head trauma. Head trauma is no fun. Concussion. All right. Concussion has been like a really interesting conversation in the past 5 years, probably. No, maybe a little bit longer than that. There's been a lot of studies, especially with like sports and kids in sports, high school kids. Concussions is a brief altered mental status followed by amnesia and potentially nausea and vomiting, right? So brief altered mental status post a blunt force injury to the head. Could be the patient fell, could be whatever the case might be. This is one of the reasons why we ask, hey, did you lose consciousness when you fell? When you got hit in the head by the softball, did you lose consciousness, right? We're trying to see, did this patient get concussed? ICP, when we start talking about head trauma. Remember, ICP stands for intracranial pressure. If we have vital signs that are changing with head trauma, we need to think about brain herniation. Now, what brain herniation means is that brain's got nowhere to go, right? There's a ton of pressure that's being built up in that head, and that brain's got to go somewhere. And what happens is that pressure starts to push down on that brainstem, and some of these vital signs start to go out of whack. We get something called Cushing's triad, right? Cushing's triad, bradycardia, hypertension, and irregular respirations. Don't forget your Cushing's triad.
Mike, with say the trauma with is head related, we're still going to take them to a trauma one?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. If we're suspecting any sort of head trauma where our patient has altered mental status, maybe these signs of ICP, things of that sort, this patient needs a neurointerventionalist. This patient is going to have to go into surgery. That is 100% a trauma call. Okay. A lot of these, believe it or not, a lot of patients that have closed head injuries, they can actually be treated at stroke centers as well, just like they would treat a hemorrhagic stroke. A lot of it's very similar, but you kind of, right there, I'm kind of already diving into somebody's maybe protocol where they're saying, no, if it's trauma related, it's got to go to a trauma center because you got to remember mechanism of injury. There could be potential other injuries. Yeah, this should be a trauma call, especially if it's trauma related. Treatment for ICP can get a little crazy. Okay, I'll tell you that firsthand. Treatment for ICP can get a little all over the place. One of them being mannitol. All right. A lot of organizations, they don't carry osmotic diuretics like mannitol. But mannitol is something that can be utilized to decrease ICP. Now, mannitol, if you remember, that's 1 gram per kilogram over 30 minutes. Another thing that we can utilize, oxygenation, positioning of the patient. So positioning the patient 15 to 30 degrees, elevating their head is another treatment that we can utilize. And if we do see Cushing's triad or we're considering brain herniation, you can actually hyperventilate these patients and cause hypocapnia, right? Breathing fast for them. Now, what the breathing rate turns into if you're giving positive pressure ventilations to provide or to cause this hypocapnia is you're going to breathe at a rate of 20 breaths per minute. It's like breathing for a child. Don't forget that you can actually hyperoxygenate. Nobody likes to use the term hyperventilate anymore because of that big study that happened where they were saying that we're decreasing cardiac output and we're doing all this harm to patients when we breathe too fast. Typically, what we want to do is we want to maintain a normal end-tidal capnography for these patients. And if you are to ever hyperoxygenate a patient because you're suspecting brain herniation, it might slow down the bleed because remember, what is oxygen? Oxygen is a vasoconstrictor. And if we're hyperoxygenating a patient, we're actually going to cause what's known as cerebral constriction. We'll actually slow down that bleed. And, but there's been some studies that say, hey, it doesn't last that long, 15, 20 minutes. A lot of the times it's seen in OR settings before they start the procedures. But you might see, and I've seen multiple test questions where they're looking for the student or whoever's taking the test to answer that you will hyperoxygenate the patient with ICP. So don't think you're not going to see that. Another interesting treatment that gets thrown around is lidocaine, believe it or not. Lidocaine, which everyone knows as an antidysrhythmic, can be given for the same concept of hyperoxygenating. It can cause cerebral vasoconstriction. All right. Typically before, I know with my protocols, and I'm not trying to teach you guys my protocols, but whenever I have a head trauma, I give lidocaine as well before I intubate to reduce or to cause cerebral constriction, right? To try to slow down that intracranial pressure. Epidural versus subdural. This is a conversation that you kind of have to understand when you take a test. Some of these test questions, they're going to give you kind of like a story of what happened to this patient. And they will give you some sort of a timeline as to when this patient fell versus when the symptoms began. And it will kind of paint you a picture of what's going on with regards to epidural versus subdural hematoma. With epidural, remember, you have a blood accumulation between the skull and the dura mater. So remember that leathery meninge that protects the brain. So between the skull and the dura mater, we have a blood accumulation in that space. This patient is going to be very similar to a concussion. What did I say with a concussion? They get a blow to the head, and then all of a sudden they have altered mental status. Instant, right? Amnesia. Now, these patients can go in and out of consciousness after they get hit in the head. This is called a lucid interval. And this occurs typically with ICP. So the patient gets hit in the head. They start to have this hematoma. So it starts to build up. Patient loses consciousness. Patient might come back around. As that hematoma and more blood starts to accumulate within that space, that patient could lose consciousness again. We call it a lucid interval. And remember, that's associated with ICP. Now, subdural hematoma, subdural bleeds. Blood accumulation between that dura mater and the brain now. So it's deeper. Hence the word sub, below, right? So this blood accumulation between the dura mater and the brain causes gradual ICP. It's slower. It's not immediate. That patient doesn't just lose consciousness immediately with subdural bleeds. It takes time, right? Patient will start to experience loss of consciousness, neurologic signs like hemiparesis, one-sided, they can't move their arms, they can't move their legs, they might get slurred speech, things of that sort. It might look like a stroke. This can occur with subdural bleeds. Now, what's interesting about subdural bleeds is time, okay? Again, I said epidural bleeds, instant, short periods of time. Subdural bleeds can take a lot longer. So there's three different classifications of subdural bleeds, if you remember. The first one is considered acute. An acute subdural bleed is any of the symptoms, loss of consciousness, or the patient becomes altered, they have one-sided weakness, whatever the case might be, within 48 hours of the injury. So two whole days go by, and now my patient's starting to experience these symptoms. Subdural bleed, acute subdural bleed. Next one, subacute hematoma or bleed. Subacute, 2 to 2 weeks, 14 days after the injury. Imagine that. If you have a patient that fell last week, and now all of a sudden they have symptoms, this is considered a subacute. The last one is considered chronic. A chronic subdural bleed is anything greater than 14 days. It could be up to months. Imagine that. 2 months later, this patient starts to experience left side or right side weakness, right? The slow bleed over time. This is known as a subdural bleed. All these patients are going to require some sort of surgery.
So could you have an aneurysm that is like slow bleeding and take over a couple weeks?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, the patients could have an aneurysm. They could have just a slow bleed that's occurring. It doesn't even mean that the patient had to have a traumatic incident, right? But typically, we would see this in some sort of like trauma setting. But no, absolutely. Be mindful if the patient is intoxicated and combative. Intoxication is always a weird one with head trauma, right? We show up, you're assessing this patient. You might see a little hematoma on their head. They got hit in the head with a beer bottle, whatever the case might be. They might've been in a bar fight, but now the patient's intoxicated. Is this patient altered because they're intoxicated, or are they altered because of the head trauma? Can you tell? The answer is no. All right. So be mindful. If you have a patient that has head trauma and you might smell alcohol, guess what the best choice of action is? Take them to a trauma center, right? We always want to err on the side of caution for that patient. Even if it's, if they're drunk and it's, and that's all it is, but we don't know. Okay. So they're going to meet a criteria of altered mental status. And these patients need to be transported as a trauma alert to these hospitals. All right. If you notice in this photo, we see spider web of the of that windshield. This is usually indicative of the patient lifted up out of their seat, unrestrained. I see the airbags deployed, so it was hard enough crash for that airbag to deploy, but the patient's face or head still hit the window. Can facial trauma be life-threatening? The answer is absolutely. First and foremost, am I going to be treating this patient for spinal precautions? Yes, 100%, man. If I see that somebody, they got out of their seat and they hit their head on that windshield, there's a chance that their head got whipped back and they could have spinal problems, right? If this patient has a nose deformity or epistaxis, can this be life-threatening? The answer is yes, right? Even though we say, hey man, epistaxis is pretty normal, make the patient lean forward, pinch their nose. Certain trauma can cause posterior nosebleeds, and this patient could actually be bleeding heavily into their own airway, right? These can be a life-threatening incident or traumatic incident. Fractured larynx, you can see here, there's a scar on this patient's larynx. Or trachea. Now, what happens with a fractured larynx is the patient takes like blunt force trauma to the neck. I know you probably heard, someone's probably told you in your life, hey man, if you don't stop, I'm gonna punch you in the throat. This is what would happen if you get punched in the throat hard enough. You could have a fractured larynx. Now, the problem with a fractured larynx is you might have, if your actual trachea opens up, now we have air that's going into interstitial space, right? And we would call that crackles around the neck, subcutaneous emphysema. Now you get subcutaneous emphysema that's leaking up and around your neck. These patients can start to experience dyspnea, and ultimately this patient's gonna need surgery.
Can you needle decompress the neck?
No, nope, nope, nope. We're not needle decompressing the neck, even though, yes, you would see subcutaneous emphysema with tension pneumo, right? If air is leaking into that same space. If the patient does have a open wound to the neck that could have caused a fractured larynx, we can apply a occlusive dressing to that neck. Because remember, we don't want air coming in and out of that open wound. We call that a sucking wound. So you would have to apply a four-sided occlusive dressing to the neck. All right. With occlusive dressings on the discussion, let's take a look at this one. These are really nice. I know in school, you typically don't have these nice chest seals that come right out of a package and you just slap on. If you are to perform an occlusive dressing, remember three-sided on the front. Typically, if there's an exit wound in the back, we're going to be applying a four-sided occlusive dressing. Occlusive dressings, the whole point behind them is you don't want air from the outside world getting into the chest, right? Every single time you breathe, you create a negative pressure and that air gets drawn in, right? And that air will get drawn into that hole. So we want air to escape the hole. We don't want new air coming back in. And if new air does get back in, then we have more of a chance of causing what we call tension pneumo. What can we use? Anything that's non-porous, right? So you can use wrappers to different things on the truck. You know, your gauze wrappers or whatever the hell you got. A really popular one is that your petroleum gauze. That's a really popular one. The size of it and everything, we can tape that down and utilize that. We already kind of discussed what a pneumo is. Remember, that's air in that pleura space around your lungs. Do we have to needle decompress because somebody has a pneumothorax? The answer is no. Remember, that patient needs to be under tension for us to actually cause or to have to relieve that air. Remember, pneumo means air. Hemothorax means blood, right? Now, the problem with the hemothorax is this patient's bleeding out internally, and this patient's going to need surgery, typically. They're going to have to stop the bleed internally. And if we do perform a needle decompress, pleural decompression, and actually start relieving some of that blood, who knows when that blood's ever going to stop, right? We can actually cause that patient to bleed out or exsanguinate. Real quick, I know this got brought up before, pneumothorax versus hemothorax. Later on in progression, a pneumothorax in late progression will have tracheal deviation and JVD. Hemothorax could have tracheal deviation, but no JVD. And on a test, they might say flattened neck veins, things of that sort. Typically, if you do see that the terminology flattened neck veins and it's trauma in relation, I'm always going to think hemothorax immediately. Flail chest, two or more ribs broken in two or more places. All right. A lot of people that were somewhat old school with regards to treatment for a flail chest segment, they've always said bulky dressing, right? Bulky dressing has been taken out a while ago. We're now going to be doing positive pressure ventilations for these patients with a flail segment, okay? That's all we're doing. Positive pressure ventilation and assisting respirations. Needle decompression. There's a couple different names for it. Don't think it's just gonna be needle decompression in every single test that you read. Pleural decompression is another one that's popular that I've seen. And needle thoracotomy is actually another term that I have seen used for needle decompression. When do we do it? We've already discussed this during tension, right? Which is considered obstructive shock. We need to relieve that basically that tension off of that mediastinum to allow the heart to pump. What are the steps? Remember, we're either going mid-clavicular or mid-axillary. If we're going mid-clavicular, second to third intercostal space, we're gonna be using a needle decompression needle, 90 degrees. Remember, we always go up in over ribs, never below ribs, okay? So you'll see some questions whenever when they talk about needle thoracotomy, where they're saying, you're gonna go into the third intercostal space below the fourth rib, whatever they're saying. If they say below, you already know it's wrong because you gotta go above the rib. If you go below the rib, you have a chance of hitting nerves and blood vessels. If you go into mid-axillary, it's fourth or fifth intercostal space. Removal of helmets with traumatic patients. Do we have to remove helmets? The answer is going to be no. We don't have to remove helmets. We're only going to be removing helmets if it is impeding on airway management. Okay, so is it necessary? Not always, but if my patient is short of breath, it's coming off. And guess what? If the helmet's coming off, should we be removing other safety gear? Yes. If the helmet's coming off, most of the time, we need to remove other safety gear to allow that person's airway to be in line naturally. If we have other safety gear, such as vests, things of that sort, it like kind of makes that patient lift off the backboard and their head's going to be like really extended back. It'll be a lot harder to maintain C-spine precautions. So we need to remove everything off that patient. Sometimes it's challenging. But this photo is perfect with regards to removal of helmet. One person's holding C-spine. That's the guy And this position, this position is holding C-spine. This guy's job is to rock the helmet back and forth. And that's all he's doing is going back and forth with that helmet until it comes off while the other person's holding C-spine. And then this guy on the right-hand side is going to take over the C-spine. What if we're unable to open the patient's mouth? All right. Sometimes this happens, right? We call it trismus, lockjaw. We're trying to maintain this patient's airway. The patient has trismus. Do we have means of relieving trismus? Of course, we have paralytics. But remember, if I give the patient a paralytic, are they going to stop breathing? Yes. So you have to weigh the good with the bad. What's going on with your patient? Is my patient's vital signs good? Can the patient breathe on their own? Are we going to be assisting ventilation? Things of that sort. Don't forget we have NPAs, okay? As long as there's no bad facial trauma, we can utilize an NPA to maintain an open airway, even if our patient has trismus. Pulmonary contusion, blunt force trauma. Right? Pulmonary contusion, signs and symptoms, patient can be experiencing chest pain, pleuritic chest pain, pain on inspiration after a sort of blunt force trauma, okay? How could this happen? Remember, any sort of blunt force to the chest that's substantial, this one that we're looking at is pretty damn substantial. People that are wearing bulletproof vests or ballistic vests that gets shot in the chest, if that bullet does not cause penetrating trauma, these patients will experience a pulmonary contusion. There we go. Spaghetti arm. Fractured extremities. All right. Closed fractures are is what we're looking at right here. Whenever we deal with a closed fracture, obviously we need to ensure that there's no bleeding underneath it, right? Is it possible that that bone could have protruded from the opposite side or anything of that sort? Absolutely, we need to check. Obviously, we're going to be assessing for PMS. If we have gross angulation where it's going to be very challenging to splint that injury in place, we're going to slowly pull gentle traction so that limb goes back into its normal position before splinting. Now, typically, what we'll do before we do that is we'll provide an analgesic. As long as we're able to remain on scene, we'll go ahead, start a line. We'll give an analgesic before we go ahead and place that limb back to where it's supposed to be. Okay. This limb that we're looking at right here, pretty standard to splint that. It's pretty angulated, but not grossly angulated. It could be way worse. Like if it was bent at like a 90 degree angle or something. Open or compound. Compound fracture just means that it's penetrated the skin. Sometimes that bone might penetrate the skin and come back into the body. So you might just see like a puncture wound around the fractured site. That is still considered a compound fracture because there was a open to the skin, right? Now, if we do see a compound fracture, we never want to try to push that bone back into the skin if it is sticking out. We'll always just splint in place. But remember, we always assess for PMS before. If you have no PMS, we get one attempt at pulling traction to obtain PMS back, right? If we're unable to get PMS after we pull traction, we're going to splint in the position of comfort. Even if there is no position of comfort, then we'll splint in the position in which it's found, and we are going to drive. Okay. How are we treating this? Analgesics. If we're treating patient's blood pressure or something of that sort, we might be treating with fluids. But for the most part, patients that have fractures, we're treating with analgesics. Fentanyl is your friend. All right. We got a scenario here. You arrive on a motor vehicle crash. Your 36-year-old male patient has an obvious left humerus fracture. He also keeps asking, what happened to my car? Is it okay? Which of the findings so far are more troubling to you as a provider. My obvious left humerus fracture, or the fact that my patient has amnesia and he keeps repeating himself. Okay. When we talk about which one is worse for a patient that has suffered a traumatic injury, altered mental status will always trump it, right? Altered mental status is usually a bad sign. It could mean that my patient's going into shock, my patient has head trauma, things of that sort. But I need to be more aware that this patient can be deteriorating on me. Okay, so we got to pay attention to that. Your patient has distended abdomen. What solid organ comes to mind first? When you guys think of solid organs and you think of distended abdomens and possible internal bleeding, what organ comes to mind? It should be the liver. Okay. Liver should come to mind first just because its size, right? And its proximity within the abdomen. A lacerated liver is going to cause massive hemorrhaging. A spleen can also cause massive hemorrhaging. Just remember, whenever you take a test and they state that the patient's experiencing shoulder pain and potentially has a distended abdomen, or a patient took a blunt force trauma to the abdomen, deferred shoulder pain is always going to be splenic rupture. But typically, if I'm reading a test question and it's telling me that this patient was involved in an accident and there's a distended abdomen, always considering liver. Liver first. Patient has hypotension. What's your treatment? These patients that are hypotensive is because of hypovolemia, right? How do we treat hypovolemia? With fluids. Giving up to 20 mLs per kilogram. What am I trying to obtain? A systolic blood pressure of at least 90. That's how we're treating it. Can I give this patient pressors? No, right? I'm not giving dopamine, norepinephrine, or epi infusions. I don't want to increase the inotropic and chronotropic effects. I don't want to make this patient bleed out faster. I want to provide them with fluids to help maintain that blood pressure. All right, cardiac tamponade. We got excess fluid that's filling up in the pericardium, causing pressure on that heart, not allowing the heart to fully expand. Now, when that happens, we have something called obstructive shock that's occurring, and these patients could have a bunch of symptoms of shock, and this patient needs that fluid to be evacuated from that pericardium. Now, remember, Beck's triad are the signs and symptoms that your patient will be experiencing. Muffled heart tones, hypotension, JVD. That's our Beck's triad. How do we treat it? Pericardiocentesis. Now, I know pericardiocentesis is not something that is done often, especially not as paramedics. There's only several agencies that I know personally that practice pericardiocentesis. Now, this is something that's pretty invasive. They take a large needle, goes underneath the sternum towards the left shoulder, and they're trying to advance this needle into the heart, into that pericardium, to actually evacuate that fluid to allow that heart to expand. Crush syndrome. All right. We talked a little bit about hyperkalemia last time we had this kind of discussion. Crush syndrome is when a limb, right, or any part of the body for that matter, is crushed for a certain period of time. Now, when we discuss, like, for example, extremity crushes, arms, legs, things of that sort, we're talking about a crush that's at least 4 hours. Okay. Per national standards, a crush longer than 4 hours will cause what's known as rhabdomyolysis. Okay, so how long does it take? Minimum of 4 hours. What rhabdomyolysis is it's when muscle tissue actually starts to become ischemic and necrotic. And when muscle turns necrotic, it releases byproducts that are poisonous, basically, to your body, right? These harmful byproducts are released from the muscle starts to break down. And once that limb is released, not only do we have an increase in hyperkalemia, but now we have this toxic chemical byproduct of muscle necrosis that's getting pushed out through your body, and then it can cause a lethal dysrhythmia. How are we treating it? First and foremost, least invasive to most invasive, oxygen, right? We're going to start with oxygen therapy. We're going to be providing fluid management. Now, fluid management is not really based on hemodynamics. I'm not saying that this patient is going to be in shock. Now, can they be? Sure, they can. But what we're trying to stop is rhabdomyolysis, right? We're trying to provide more fluids to make that patient not dehydrated. And we can give analgesics. Patient's going to be in pain. Once we start getting ready to lift up that object, we can now treat with a high dose of albuterol, because albuterol is going to help that potassium that I said that dumps into the bloodstream get back into the cells. We can also give sodium bicarb, right? 1 milliequivalent per kilogram. And in the hospital settings, they can actually give glucose and insulin. Now, you might say, well, insulin's just going to make the blood glucose drop, and then they give it glucose, and that's just going to bring it back up. So it's kind of like a teetering effect. By doing so, it's also going to be drawing potassium back into the cell. So there's a lot of different treatments that we can utilize for CRUSH syndrome. All right. Autonomic hyperreflexia syndrome. Talking about spinal cord injury, SCI, spinal cord injury. Okay. Now, this is an interesting one, and it's probably something that you read about, and this is going to jog your memory. A patient has spinal cord injury above T6. So above T6, they have a spinal cord injury, and they have paralysis, right? And a parasympathetic stimulation, right? So this parasympathetic stimulation makes them turn really cool to the touch and pale below the injury. It's really weird. So above the injury, right, that patient is going to have vasodilation and the patient's going to be sweating. So let's say above T6, up this way, my face is going to be profusely sweating, but below my pale and cold to the touch. Another thing that you're going to note with these kind of injuries with autonomic hyperreflexia syndrome is the blood pressure is going to skyrocket. Okay. Systolic blood pressure is going to be above 200. Diastolic blood pressure is going to be above 130. Okay. But you're going to note that difference in your assessment above the injury and below the injury. When can your patient be pregnant? Okay. Obviously, puberty. Now, that's going to vary with people, right? Some people have puberty or hit puberty when they're 12. Sometimes some girls are 9, right? So it's all going to be dependent on when that happens. Is there abdominal pain with this pregnancy? And what are we considering with abdominal pain, right? Whenever we have a patient that is potentially pregnant, meaning that they are of childbearing age and they have abdominal pain, what should you as a provider be thinking? Ectopic pregnancy. And this is why we ask certain questions with regards to abdominal pain with women that are of childbearing age. When was your last menstrual cycle? Has there been any spotting? You know, we ask different questions to try to see what they were doing when this pain occurred, and could it be an ectopic pregnancy or pregnancy in general, right? Is there bleeding, right? Is there any spotting that's been noted? And how should these patients be transported? Okay, how should these patients be transported with abdominal pain and vaginal bleeding on their left side? Okay, these patients should be placed on their left side. Now you might say, what's up with this freaking left side, man? Why can't the patient be placed on their right side? What does it matter? Well, your great blood vessels ride along the right side of your spinal cord, okay? Because they're running on the right side of your spinal cord, that there is a chance that if you place the patient on their right side, there could still be pressure on those vena cava causing supine hypotensive syndrome, right? This is why we place the patient on their left side, to reduce the chances of that occurring, right? typically this occurs after 20th week of gestation, where that uterus is large enough and I guess provides enough weight to even cause that kind of pressure. There she is, Octomom. Paragravida, paraparent. How many kids does this mother have currently? Whenever we write our para, right? How many kids does this person currently have? Gravida, how many times have they been pregnant, right? They could have had abortions. They could have had spontaneous miscarriages, whatever the case might be. Gravida is how many times they've been pregnant. Para is how many times they, how many kids they currently have. If you ever hear the terminology premigravida, all that the question is trying to say is that this patient, it's their first time. First time being pregnant, premigravida. Multigravida, typically when somebody has multiple kids, they're considered multigravida. Now, if we see somebody who is multigravida, something we need to think about, someone who's had multiple kids, someone who's been pregnant many times, is their delivery going to be different than somebody who it's their first time? And the answer is absolutely. Now, why is this going to change in our assessment? If I find out that this is the person's first time and I find out, hey, they're having contractions, I'm a lot more lenient on saying, hey, we need to do an assessment and look for crowning unless she says she feels something there. Sometimes these deliveries can take 24 hours, right? Multigravida, it's happening now. We need to do an assessment. Is this patient crowning? Is delivery going to be imminent right here, right now? Let's go. Amniotic fluid in post-delivery. So the child is already born and we see another water break or more amniotic fluid. That's telling you that there's going to be another delivery. Okay. So be mindful. If you start seeing more amniotic fluid coming out of the vaginal opening after or postpartum, you need to expect an additional delivery. Postpartum, just remember, post means after, partum, delivery. So after delivery, if there's still bleeding that's occurring, there's a couple of different ways that we can slow down the bleeding process. First one that you're looking at here on this photo is a fundal massage, right? Fundal massage can occur to slow down the bleed. Another one can be latching, having the baby latch to mom, and breastfeeding can slow it down. Because remember, breastfeeding is actually going to cause a hormone called oxytocin to kick on, or Pitocin. And that is going to slow down hemorrhaging because that's going to cause uterine contraction. If both of those aren't working, you can actually give Pitocin, all right? 10 milligrams, or is it 10 units IM as an injection, we can go ahead and slow down this bleed by causing uterine contraction. So different measures postpartum of slowing down bleeds. How do we assess for blood loss? Sometimes easier said than done, because guess what? They're going to ask you, hey, how much blood loss was noted? Hopefully you're going to have some sort of way of showing them, like, hey, check this out. How many pads were used? Were pads used to stop or slow down the bleed? And were you swapping the pads out as they got saturated? Not a bad idea to keep count on how many pads get soaked and what pads are being utilized, so you can show that to the hospital facility so they can have an idea how much blood loss has been going on. Some delivery presentations. This is classic, man. I don't care if you're taking the National Registry exam, if you're taking any sort of OB test, there's always, always, always going to be presentation questions. First one, and the ones that we want to see, is cephalic, right? A cephalic presentation is head first. Now, some head first can be, are better than others, right? But that's when we're going to see crowning. That's when typically, hopefully mom has been going to an OB and knows that her baby is in position of cephalic and is going to have a normal delivery. Sometimes mom might know that that baby's in breech, right? Breech presentation is one of those deliveries that can be very dangerous, all right? This is one of the deliveries where we're talking knees to chest, potential need for asking mom to pant, right? And we might even have to apply our hands or fingers inside of that vaginal opening to create an airway for the baby. Limb presentation, if a leg is sticking out or an arm is sticking out, this is super dangerous. Not only is it dangerous for a baby because the baby's going to suffocate within the birth canal, but also mom can actually have some serious complications and cause a lot of trauma. So again, knees to chest, ask mom to pant. Prolapse cord, you better freaking drive. Push on the pedal, right? The problem now with prolapse cord is if that baby starts to enter that birth canal and push against that cord's gonna start to cut off circulation to the baby. The baby will die. So this is one of the other times where you're gonna be able to place your hand into that birth canal and actually push pressure on that baby to get them off of the cord if the baby is pushing against the cord. You will be able to feel that prolapse cord while it's hanging out to see if there is a pulse or not on it. Okay, so if there is a strong pulse on that cord, you know that the baby's not pushing against it. Does that mean that the baby isn't going to be pushing against it for long? No. So understand that once that baby starts to enter the birth canal, it's game time. You're going to have to try to maneuver that baby off of the cord. Get to the hospital. It's a serious emergency. Another serious emergency that can occur is a nuchal cord. Nuchal cord is when that umbilical cord is wrapped around the baby's neck. Obviously, this is going to cause asphyxiation, and this child could die before they're even fully delivered. If that head starts to come out in cephalic position and we note that there's a nuchal cord, you're going to get one attempt at taking that cord and putting it up and over the baby's head. If you're unsuccessful, we're going to go ahead and clamp and then cut. Just be mindful. Don't cut the baby. Postpartum depression. Postpartum depression is a real thing where the mother can suffer from depression after delivery. Okay. In some cases with postpartum depression, mother will refuse to see her child. All right. The mother wants nothing to do with the baby. So much so that the mom will even stop breastfeeding or taking care of the baby. So babies have died because of postpartum depressions. For even some mothers, they're going to turn to drugs and alcohol, okay, to deal with their delivery. So be mindful of this is something that you could come across. PID or pelvic inflammatory disease, typically pelvic pain with vaginal discharge. I'm not going to tell you, hey, man, the discharge has got to be yellow every time, or the discharge has got to be gray. Could be different colors, foul smelling, but it's going to be painful, right? Now, the problem, if left untreated, PID can cause infertility. So be mindful. Again, if we have pelvic or abdominal pain, we're more considering ectopic pregnancy first. If this mother has a STD that's left untreated, it can turn into PID, and PID can cause infertility and other complications, okay? But remember that, signs and symptoms, pelvic pain, vaginal discharge. An ovarian cyst. For many, cysts in the ovaries is not a problem, right? For most women, there's no symptoms at all. But understand that for some, they can experience abdominal tenderness on palpation. They can have back or flank pain and irregular vaginal bleeding. Okay. This is sometimes misdiagnosed, especially for us, because we don't deal with a lot of diagnosing ovarian cysts, but these patients could have a lot of different signs and symptoms that we need to be mindful of. Spontaneous abortion. Irregular spotting, abdominal pain. This patient could be pretty late on in their pregnancy, and then all of a sudden they have a bloody show. We need to be mindful that spontaneous abortions can occur. And a lot of the times mom will know. It's like, hey, the baby stopped moving. So we take this very serious, and we're emergency driving to the OB facility. Embolisms. Embolisms is an interesting one because typically when we talk about an embolism, everyone thinks of like PE, right? So we got pulmonary embolisms. This patient has shortness of breath. That's cute. We talked about it with respiratory, but what's causing these PEs and what did that happen to the patient recently, right? Did that patient recently have a surgery or a traumatic incident that could have caused a PE? Does the patient have history of DVTs or deep vein thrombosis? Did the patient deliver recently? Believe it or not, amniotic fluid can cause pulmonary embolisms or embolisms, period, right? Another really interesting one is oral contraceptives. I'm not saying all oral contraceptives are going to cause embolisms, but there are cases where it does, okay? So we need to be mindful that embolisms can occur with pregnancy. And I already discussed ectopic pregnancy. Remember, ectopic pregnancy is whenever you have a fetus growing outside of the uterus, okay? Could be in fallopian tubes, could be outside of the uterus, wherever, it's just not inside the uterus. All right, we're moving right along. Placenta previa is right here. All right, so is placenta previa an emergency? Typically not, believe it or not. All it means is that placenta is growing over the cervix. So what's going to happen is blood's going to be coming out of the cervix. So the mom's going to have vaginal bleeding. Now, typically, believe it or not, placenta previa is not painful, painless bleeding. And the only time where placenta previa becomes a real, true emergency is if that baby is delivering. So if mom is experiencing contractions and baby is trying to come out while that placenta is blocking the vaginal opening or birth canal, now we have an emergency. Okay. But for the most part, this is going to have to get moved. And it's not a real true emergency for mom or for baby. Abrupto placenta, on the other hand, is an emergency. Okay. Abrupto placenta is when the actual placenta tears off of the uterine wall. A lot of times this is due to trauma, right? Mom's fell or in a motor vehicle accident, and that placenta tears off of that uterine wall. Now, what happens is that mom now not only has a bloody show or starts to bleed, but it's also extremely painful, sharp abdominal pain with abrupto placenta, and can be definitely an emergency. Preeclampsia is something that you need to understand. Now, there's severe preeclampsia and there's preeclampsia. Now, we know that we always correlate preeclampsia with blood pressure, right? Okay, so preeclampsia is high blood pressure with pregnancy. Now, it's not just high blood pressure with pregnancy. There's some signs and symptoms that are associated with it. Now, when I say high blood pressure, preeclampsia starts at 140 over 90, right? Now, this occurs after the 20th week of gestation, and there's a triad. There's always a triad of something, right? The triad of symptoms. Now, the first symptom is edema. Now, this edema could be in the face, ankles, hands, just dispersed edema. Next one, hypertension. So we got edema, hypertension. The last one is protein in their urine, okay? When we go from preeclampsia to severe preeclampsia, we're now talking about a systolic blood pressure greater than 160 or a diastolic blood pressure greater than 110. And they're going to have severe symptoms. Severe symptoms of preeclampsia includes headache, dizziness, nausea and vomiting, agitation, right? Maybe rapid weight gain, visual disturbance. They might see floaters, things of that sort. The patient is experiencing more than just hypertension, and they have a lot of other symptoms. This is considered severe eclampsia, and this is typically when we would have to treat preeclampsia. Okay. Now, the treatment of preeclampsia is going to typically include mag sulfate. Now, we know mag sulfate is used for eclampsia, which I'm going to get to here in a second. But if I give mag sulfate to a patient that has severe preeclampsia, I could reduce the chance of that patient having a seizure. Another thing that we can give it is antihypertensives. So an antihypertensive might be something like labetalol, right? 10 milligrams we can give to that patient to try to lower down that blood pressure to reduce some of those symptoms. right? If we do not treat preeclampsia, what's it going to turn into? Eclampsia. What is eclampsia? Eclampsia is seizures with pregnancy. How do we treat it? Mag sulfate. Remember that, 4 grams, right? We're going to be giving that 4 grams as a drip for preeclamptic patients to, as a smooth muscle relaxer, to stop or slow down that, those seizure activities. Can I give benzodiazepines to this patient? If the patient's actively seizing, can we give a benzodiazepine? Yes. Is it going to stop the seizure? Sure. But will that seizure continue? Yes. Okay. So if you just treat with a benzo, like let's say we give Versed, it's not ultimately fixing the problem. We need to give mag sulfate to these patients. All right. Vomiting and weakness with pregnancy. Now there's something called hyperemesis gravidum. Now, some patients have it worse than others. Some women, when they get pregnant, it's butterflies and flowers and they're having a good time. And others, they're vomiting, they feel sick, they feel weak, they have a lot of complications. Now, with hyperemesis gravidum, obviously hyperemesis, the patient's vomiting a lot. These patients are going to have severe weight loss, vomiting, dehydration during pregnancy, right? And what do these patients need that are vomiting and weak? Fluids and antiemetics, right? An antiemetic might be something like Zofran that we can give to these patients to help reduce nausea. Believe it or not, with hyperemesis gravidum, we can actually treat that. This is a strange one, but with Benadryl, okay? So not only would we use fluids and something like Zofran, but we can also treat this patient with Benadryl. Pregnancy with trauma. I found this photo and it's perfect, right? Now, just because somebody's pregnant and traumatic, or just because somebody was involved in a trauma, doesn't mean that we always backboard, right? If we don't have to backboard, we're not worried about spinal immobilization. Can I lay that patient on their left side? Of course, it doesn't matter. I'm gonna place that patient in a position of comfort or if my patient is over 20 week gestation, I wanna place them on their left side. Now, what if they do have to be on a backboard? This photo shows exactly what we would have to do. Place towels or sheets, whatever you have, underneath the right side. What's that gonna do? It's gonna prop the patient up. It's gonna take their abdomen and move it over to their left side, okay? Kind of like in cardiac arrest, if we have a patient who's pregnant and you have no means of moving that patient over, you can also have somebody literally hold on to the abdomen and pull to the left side to kind of displace that abdomen to get it off of the vena cava. Meconium staining. This is one that not only scares providers, but students for sure. You get a test question on meconium staining. You know, how are we treating it? What are we doing about it? Now, a couple things that you need to note about meconium staining. First, the higher the gestational age of the baby, the more chance that there's going to be meconium staining. Now, what is meconium staining? Meconium is the baby's first stool, right? And it can get mixed up in the amniotic fluid. Now, if it does get mixed up in the amniotic fluid, should the baby be breathing inside of mom? No, right? So just because there's amniotic fluid and meconium inside the amniotic fluid doesn't mean that the baby's going to be breathing it in. Now, there's a higher chance of this baby breathing it in if the baby gets what they call stressed. Now, how would a baby get stressed? If they become hypoxic for whatever reason. Could be because the baby's getting too large, right? The baby is delayed, right? The baby is over 42 weeks gestation, and the baby is so large in the amniotic sac that it's pushing up against everything and starting to become hypoxic. Maybe the baby's umbilical cord is getting compressed or has a knot in it. Whatever the case might be, if that baby starts to lack oxygen, there's a chance of that baby aspirating amniotic fluid. So it's It's been an interesting topic over the past several years. Just because a baby has meconium staining does not mean that this baby is going to die, right? I remember the discussion, like when I was in paramedic school, was, hey man, if you got meconium staining, we got to intubate the baby immediately. Is that still how it's treated today? No, it's not. Just because you see meconium staining and amniotic fluid does not mean you're going to stop a delivery, right? Delivery is still going to go on. It's still going to be normal. And more than likely, that baby is going to be fine. Just because there's meconium staining does not mean that the baby's going to aspirate it. Okay. Just clean it off. We're going to suction as normal. If the baby is what they consider vigorous, we're fine. The baby's crying after we dry, warm, stimulate. The baby's crying, kicking. We're getting our Apgar score. Everything is normal. We're fine with it. But if the baby is non-vigorous, we already dry, warm, stimulate, and that kid is not moving, all right? And we see meconium staining around their mouth. We see meconium staining inside their airway. Now is when we need to consider positive pressure ventilations and intubation. Now, intubation is interesting with meconium staining because we're going to be utilizing this device right here. That device right there is called a meconium aspirator. And if you see, we have this ET tube right here, right? So the meconium aspirator sits on that tube, and then we provide suction on this side, right? So how it's going to work is somebody has a laryngoscope, which we're going to talk about here, which laryngoscope to grab. We're going to be visualizing the vocal cords. You ask for a tube. Tube gets passed through the vocal cords. You apply the meconium aspirator, and then you suction out of the trachea. Now, we have meconium jump up into that tube and hopefully out into our suction canister. The problem here now is that that meconium staining is now inside of our tube, our ET tube. Can I leave that ET tube and just start providing positive pressure ventilations to that ET tube? The answer is no, you shouldn't be. We should take that tube out, grab another tube, a fresh tube. So whoever's holding that, visualizing the glottic opening, re-intubates. And then if you have to provide more suction, we can do so. Or you're just going to provide the BVM and start bagging that kid with a brand new ET tube with no meconium inside the tube. We're trying to get all that junk up and out. Believe it or not, there was a lot of little kids that were getting intubated before this whole research has been done on meconium staining, where they're saying, hey man, we've been intubating way more little babies than we had to, and we've caused more complications than good by this forceful intubations and suctioning than the kids didn't even need it. So this is only if the kid really needs it.
So when it comes to the non-vigorous newborns, then with the meconium staining, it's first positive pressure ventilation and then intubation.
So,
or is it suction, positive pressure, then intubation?
So good question. Now the baby comes out, baby's non-vigorous, right? Dry warm stimulate. The problem now is that baby becomes hypoxic and the baby's going to start becoming bradycardic. So what I would recommend is we're going to start positive pressure ventilations while we get our intubation equipment ready. And then we're going to intubate that child. Okay. If I would imagine if the OB staff knows that the baby's already had meconium staining and all this stuff is going on, they would already have intubation equipment there readily available. We won't. Okay. So don't ever not consider positive pressure ventilations when, especially when a child's non-vigorous or not breathing, to prepare intubation equipment. We should be ventilating while we're getting all that stuff set up.
Thanks.
Once the child's been delivered, all right, we've kind of just talked about this dry warm stimulate, right? Before we dry warm stimulate, what do we have to do? Suction. What do we suction first? Mouth, then nose. Remember, you have one mouth, two nostrils. So we start with number one and then we go to number two. So as soon as that face or that head comes out, we could start our suction. We use a bulb syringe, try to get as much of that, maybe amniotic fluid, mucus, discharge, whatever it is, out of that baby's airway. Then we're going to dry warm stimulate. Hopefully that baby becomes vigorous, and then we can provide skin to skin, allow the kid to, or the baby to go on to mom, and then we can start getting our Apgar score, things of that sort. What if the child does not react to our dry warm stimulate? Okay. This is now when we are going to consider, again, positive pressure ventilations. If the kid is non-vigorous post-delivery, after dry warm stimulate, we need to provide positive pressure ventilations. And then skin to skin. Hopefully that works. Apgar, remember, first minute and then 5 minutes. Jumping into peds. All right. There's a lot here on this slide. There's a lot going on. And the whole reason why I put this here is just to show you there's a lot of changes in vital signs. Do you have to memorize all the vital signs? No, I'll be honest with you. You don't have to memorize it. Just what I want you to memorize and want you to understand is that the younger the child, the faster their vital signs are. Like when we're talking about heart rate and talking about respiratory rate, they're faster, and that's considered normal. With regards to blood pressure, it's going to be lower. Please know this about blood pressures. 70 plus H times 2, all right? Now it's showing that for kids that are greater than the age of 1. If the child's less than 1, systolic less than 70 is considered low, abnormal. But this is right here is hypotension on a child greater than 1 year of age. If the child has, if you do this calculation, let's say they're 4 years old, right? 4 times 2 equals 8 plus 70, 78 would be that child's hypotensive systolic blood pressure. Anything below 78 for that four-year-old is considered hypotension. So we want to be above that. Okay. Please understand that. With regards to pediatric meds, I'm going to be honest with you. You are going to see pediatric dosages on any exam you take. All right. I don't think they usually get crazy with like obscure medications. I would probably look at your basic cardiac meds, know the dose for atropine, adenosine, amiodarone, epinephrine, things of that sort. You're going to see those type of questions. And you might even get like, oh, your patient is a 7-year-old and this is how much they weigh. How are you going to be treating this cardiac dysrhythmia? And they're going to give you different answers. And some of them might have the same med. And you're like, yes, I want to give adenosine to this kid, but what's the dose? Please know them. Fluid administration. All right. Does fluid administration change based on the child's age? And the answer is yes. Okay. Neonates, newborns, right? Anybody less than a month old. And children with congenital heart defects are going to get 10 mLs per kilogram, up to 10 mLs per kilogram, right? Now, when we say congenital heart defects, there's a lot, man. If you remember in talking about the pediatric emergency chapter, there is a ton of congenital heart defects that are out there. One big one that I see a lot is tetralogy of Fallot. Tetralogy of Fallot is 4 different heart defects in one patient, right? Ventricular septal defect, pulmonary stenosis, right ventricular hypertrophy, and overriding aorta. So 4 different cardiac dysrhythmia, or not cardiac dysrhythmia, it's cardiac defects in one kid. It's called tetralogy of Fallot. These kids are very sick with any sort of congenital heart defect. Just remember, we can't overload them with fluids. Infants and older, we can go up to 20 mLs per kilogram. So we can increase our fluid volume. With pediatrics, there was a big push on hypovolemia. They're given up to 60 mLs per kilogram for hypovolemic children. Now, again, we're giving up to 20 mLs per time that we're going to give fluids to these kids, but they're giving some serious fluid volume to little kids that are suffering from hypovolemia. But remember, for neonates and peds with congenital heart defects, chill. Relax on the fluids. Bradycardia with kids. Bradycardia with kids. What causes it? Hypoxia. Whenever I see bradycardia on a test and it's talking about a child, instantly I'm thinking airway. Okay. I love this, how they always word it, man. I don't know why they don't just put an extra box talking about positive pressure ventilations. They don't, right? So what they show here is assessment and support. It says assist breathing with positive pressure ventilations and oxygen as necessary. Typically, how this gets handled, if my patient is having bradycardia, right? And obviously, little kids should not have bradycardia. It's not an adult, right? So this kid is going to be suffering from signs of shock, right? Because their heart rate needs to be way faster. So this kid's going to have signs and symptoms of shock, hypotension, right? Bradycardia, if it is less than 60, despite 30 seconds of positive pressure ventilations, we need to start chest compressions, okay? First thing that we're going to do, obviously, is ventilate for this child. Positive pressure ventilations. If that doesn't work, we start up our chest compressions. We're going to perform our 2 minutes of chest compressions. With that 2 minutes of chest compressions, our first medications that we're going to administer is epinephrine. Okay. Epinephrine, remember, is 0.01 milligrams per kilogram, which you see here. This is this newest algorithm update. You can see it down here, 2020. We can give that every 3 to 5 minutes. If epinephrine doesn't work, we can attempt atropine. So it's kind of like with cardiac arrest. You do 2 minutes, we give them medication, 2 minutes of CPR, reassess, any change, no change. Okay, now we're going to give atropine, 2 minutes, any change. The kid is non-intubated. We're doing 15 to 2 as long as we have two or more rescuers. If we're just bagging the child, 15 to 2. All right, pediatric airways, a little different than adults. We know because it's a kid, right? Smaller airway. Tongue is proportionally larger, mandible smaller. That tongue is more of a problem, right? Can cause an obstruction. The epiglottis, proportionally larger, floppy, which makes intubation a little bit different for a small child. Trachea is smaller, narrower, shorter, positioned more anterior on the patient's larynx or oral pharynx. Well, you know, positioning for intubation is going to change a little bit. The cartilage rings may not be fully developed, and supplemental pressure to the patient's neck can cause an obstruction. We know, looking at somebody's trachea, that there's cartilage rings that keep it open. These little kids, especially real little kids, those cartilage rings are not developed. Even if I hyperextend that little kid's head back, you can cut off the airflow to the trachea. Now, if you provide any sort of pressure to that kid's neck, you have a chance of causing an obstruction. Problematic, right? Now, talking about croup, it's a viral infection. Now, a lot of people, they always say, like, man, I have a hard time memorizing croup versus epiglottitis, because I've always seen that question. It's always in paramedic tests. It talks about a viral infection that has mild grade fever. Is it croup? Is it epiglottitis? Remember, croup is a small word. Let me show you, compared to epiglottitis. It's like half the size. Think of viral and bacterial. Which word is smaller? Viral is smaller. Croup is viral. Epiglottitis is the larger word. That is a bacterial infection, right? Now, croup, let's talk a little bit about it. Viral infection transmitted by droplets, kind of like COVID nowadays, right? Affects kids between the ages of 6 months to 6 years old, right? And it affects the most narrowest part of their airway, called the subglottic space, right? Just below their glottic opening. This is why that patient is going to experience stridor. These patients, now, whenever you see a test question talking about croup, they're always going to mention one of two things. One being this low grade or mild fever, right? They're going to include this low grade fever and a seal bark cough. Either they're going to put the word seal or they're just going to say the patient has like a bark cough. They're going to use some sort of adjective. Once you see that in a test question, you know it's croup. Okay. These patients with severe croup understand that they can become altered, right? Their mental status can change. This is not good. This means that it's been going on far too long. Treatment for croup: humidified oxygen, position of comfort. Okay. These patients are going to require racemic epinephrine. Now, I know we talked about racemic epinephrine last time. Remember, that's 0.5 milligrams nebulized, 1 in 1,000. Allow that patient to breathe it over time. It takes several minutes for them to breathe in that racemic epi. It works awesome with croup. What does it not work awesome for? Epiglottitis. Okay. And a lot of students, they see epiglottitis and they're like, oh yeah, racemic epi. No, man. Why? We don't want to further agitate this kid. When we talk about epiglottitis, what we're talking about is a life-threatening, rare condition in which that epiglottis swells and literally blocks off their trachea. Super dangerous. All right. This typically affects kids like between 2 to 7. Doesn't mean other ages don't get epiglottitis. Even you as an adult can get epiglottitis. It's just not as severe for you. You have a way larger airway, right? But the kids typically between that age, 2 to 7, it's really dangerous and it's more likely seen then. This child appears sick. They are in the sniffing position, sometimes tripod position, right? They have their chin forward. They're drooling. They're unable to swallow. This kid has a severe fever, not a mild grade fever like with croup, right? This patient has a high fever. This can progress rapidly and severe to the point where this patient can stop breathing altogether. Now, talking about treatment, all we can do for this patient, position of comfort, drive them to the hospital, and provide oxygen if it's tolerated. If the kid's not having it, stop, right? I'm bringing mom or dad with me. This kid's gonna be as comfortable as possible with mom or dad, and I'll even allow mom or dad to hold a blow-by technique. I am not going to start a line on this kid. I am not gonna look in this kid's airway. I am not gonna do anything that's going to cause this kid to cry or get over-agitated, because I don't want to progress and make that epiglottitis worse, right? That's how we're treating it. This is a really interesting slide. I highly recommend to take like a photo of this one in particular, because it's got really good information with regards to intubating kids, okay? I'll look over here on this side first when we start talking about tube sizes. Tube sizes are going to be dependent typically on age, right? It says less than 1 year old, we're going to be utilizing a 3.5. 1 to 2 years of age, we'll go up to a 4. If they're greater than 2 years of age, that's when they start utilizing this math equation. For an uncuffed tube, 4 plus the age divided by 4, and cuffed tube is 3.5 plus the age divided by 4. Now, most recent guidelines for PALS, they're stating that, hey, we don't have to only use uncuffed tubes for really little kids and infants. We can actually use cuffed tubes now. So I think this little algorithm here is going to become a little bit more popular with selecting tube sizes. When it comes to blades, Miller blade is substantially better and easier to utilize for very small kids. Again, remember, their epiglottis is a lot larger. When we talk about how these blades are utilized, remember, the Miller blade actually grabs the epiglottis versus the Mac blade that goes in the molecular space. If you look here, look at how many of these kids require Miller blades. premature newborn, zero. Full-term newborn to 1 year old, a one miller, right? 2 years old, two adolescents, a two miller blade. So they're saying all peds utilize miller blades. Now, miller blade is probably half the width of a Mac blade. So it's a lot more narrow. Kids have a lot smaller airways, a lot easier to see inside of their oropharynx if we're utilizing a miller blade versus a Mac. Okay. And again, how their epiglottis is larger, easier to utilize that miller blade. States, once they're above adolescence age, we can start adding this Mac blade in and go up in size. What if the child's parent isn't on scene? Shitty calls, man. I hate when this happens. When you get on scene and it's a little kid and mom's not there. Can we treat them? What if the kid doesn't want me there? No, I'm fine. But they're 10 years old. Can they actually refuse transport or treatment for that matter? The answer is no, right? Once we're there, we have to make sure that this kid gets treated. Did you try calling the kid's parents? Call mom or dad, and then have them decide what's going on, because especially if it's not serious, or believe it or not, if the child is at school, their teacher can have actually legal rights to say what happens with the child, even if it's like a small cut on their knee or something, and it's something that they can deal with, but somebody called 911. Just because they called us doesn't mean that the kid's going to get transported, especially if the school can take care of it. If the kid is not at school or at daycare or anything of that sort, we have to transport, unfortunately, especially if we can't get a hold of mom or dad. Kids are not able to refuse, unless they're emancipated, right? All right, your arrival of this six-year-old kid who fell. He's at a birthday party. Apparently he got hurt at a playground. Parents are not on scene. We just talked about this. We got to treat this kid, right? It's a hot summer day. It's 98 degrees out. You note that the kids have been drinking soda, eating pizza. So the kid's on caffeine also. Patient's very tachycardic at a rate of 168 and sweating. How are we treating this kid? Well, for one, we just stated that we're going to be transporting this kid if we're unable to get a hold of the kid's parents, right? If mom or dad comes and they say, no, the kid's fine. I'm going to monitor them. I'll take them to the hospital, whatever the case might be. Cool. We can get a refusal signed by mom or dad. But with this kid's parents aren't on scene, I'm guessing because of this type of question, we're unable to get this kid's parents. We're going to treat this kid. Because of the tachycardia, because of the sweating, because it's 98 degrees out, because the kid's drinking caffeine, There's a lot of things added to this question that's telling me that I need to treat this kid, okay? I'm not just going to be like, oh, I'm going to sit there and just take him to the hospital, especially on a test question. I am going to provide an IV. I'm going to give this kid fluids, right? And active cooling, right? That might be ice pack to the neck, something of that sort. But active cooling for sure and fluids. Remember, the kid is up to 20 mLs per kilogram of fluid to try to get that heart rate to decrease. Febrile seizures. Please know this. It's an abrupt rise in temperature. It's not a gradual increase in temp. It's an abrupt rise in temperature, and that's what causes the seizure. How do we fix it? First thing that we can do, expose, right? This kid's little one piece, whatever the hell this kid's wearing, it's got to go, all right? That's causing that temperature to be hotter, right? So we're going to expose. If the kid is able to swallow, we can utilize Tylenol or Motrin, whatever that, if the parents have something that they've been treating the fever with, absolutely. We can also utilize lukewarm water. We're not going to use cold packs. We're not going to use ice. We're not going to use really cold water, right? Because I don't want to drastically change direction and temperature. It should be gradual, right? So how can we treat it? Those three things. Take off clothing, We can use Tylenol, and we could also use lukewarm water. With operations, is my scene safe, and what resources do I have to make my scene safe? Utilize PD, please, on test questions. Whenever they have a question that has to do with any sort of suicide, domestic violence, anything that sounds dangerous, is PD on scene and have they cleared the scene? Is there a suicide threat? If that person is willing to take their own life, do they care about yours? No. Did the patient confirm the suicide threat, or did somebody tell you that that patient had a suicide threat? We don't take, unfortunately, this might sound crazy, we typically don't take other people's opinions on suicide. Oh, my sister said she's going to kill herself, right? Okay, so let's talk to her. Ma'am, are you trying to hurt yourself? No, I'm not trying to hurt myself. What? Who told you that? Oh, your sister, you know, is worried about you, whatever. They can't tell us that somebody's trying to hurt themselves, and then we're just like, we believe them and get that patient Baker Act and things of that sort. Doesn't work like that. We have to get confirmation from the patient. Typically, when someone is threatening to commit suicide, they do tell us, yes, you know, I want to hurt myself. I've been trying to kill myself. Whatever the case might be, we get confirmation from the patient. Is domestic violence something that we're considering? All right. Again, this can be, these things can blow up on scene when you don't even, you're not even there for that, right? So be mindful. Let's say that domestic violence begins in front of you and you're on scene. Remember, your safety is most important. We need to get out. If there's any other bystanders that are around, can we get them to leave with us? Absolutely. But we need to get away from harm's way. What if a family member gets upset, and can we reason with them, right? This does happen where we get on scene and somebody's yelling at us because either a response time that they're not happy with, they're not happy with our treatment, whatever the case might be, they want something else to happen, or they might be upset with that patient. We need to try our best to reason with that person before things get out of hand, all right? Tell them what we're there for. We're there to help. Parking of emergency vehicles. This is an interesting photo because some of it is very good. I mean, we can see that we have a car accident here, right? We have a car accident here. It looks like there's some smoke. We got a couple suppression units. This truck right here is our blocking vehicle. You can see they have blocked pretty almost two lanes. They left some space here for traffic to go around, but you can tell that they landed a helicopter. So they ended up closing off the road. If I were to guess, they probably have PD downhill from here because this does look like a slope. They probably have PD downhill that shut off traffic down there. If PD did not do that and we are keeping this traffic flowing over here on this side, this rescue should not be parked like this, okay? This rescue should be in this position down the street, right? With the back of the rescue facing towards this car accident. Because remember, that stretcher is going to be coming out of the back of the rescue. We already have this engine or suppression unit blocking this car accident, which is perfect. How they position this truck is perfect. I don't want this truck facing the opposite way, right? Because if, some, God forbid, a car hits that truck, I don't want it rolling or moving into my scene. I want this truck to be facing away from my scene. Also, if this truck has to leave, I don't want them to have to go off-road to leave, or I don't want them to have to back out into traffic. They can just drive straight back onto the road. So very good job by this crew. The only thing different, obviously, would be where this rescue is parked. What if there's a hazmat? I'll tell you right now, every single operations test I've ever seen always talks about uphill, upwind. Anybody who's ever done fire school is going to laugh at that because they've seen that question multiple times. It's just, it is what it is. Uphill, upwind is where you're going to be parking if there is any chance of hazardous materials, smoke, things of that sort. We want to stay away from it. Also, what happens if you notice that there's a hazmat? You walk up, you're assessing the scene, and it's a hazmat. There's heavy amounts of unknown fluid pumping out of a tanker truck, things of that sort. Go back. What are you doing there? Right? You're in the wrong place. You're a paramedic. Get, move out. Go back to the truck. Maybe pull the truck further away, uphill, upwind. Get out of there. Car accident. We just talked about where we're going to be parking. Lifting patients safely. Please, please, please. What if you and your partner are lifting a patient and all of a sudden your partner says, ow, my back hurts. Don't be like, hey man, toughen up. Let's go. Stop. Get additional help, right? If somebody gets hurt, we don't continue with the operation. We need to make sure that that person's okay. We'll call for additional resources. We can treat there on scene. I have a couple different things here on this. We have first backboarding. Backboarding is an interesting one because a lot of organizations are getting rid of it. backboarding is typically used for spinal motion restriction. Can we use it to move patients? Of course, yeah, we can. But typically we're using it because we're trying to immobilize that spine. It's a hard, straight board, unlike our scoop stretcher over here. Scoop stretcher. We see that the scoop stretcher is concaved, right? We can pick people up. Scoop stretchers are great to move people from one area to another. It's also really good when patients have like pelvic instability, hip fractures, things of that sort, to just scoop them up if we're not suspecting cervical spine injury. If you're suspecting spinal cord injury, we are still utilizing backboards unless your protocols say otherwise. Scoop stretchers are not for or not intended for spinal cord injury. Stokes basket, that's what you see down here. This is a Stokes basket. Stokes baskets are typically used for unstable terrain. So urban search and rescue, things of that sort, where they start dealing with rocks and or even like building collapse and stuff like that. You're trying to move patients. They utilize a Stokes basket. And look at how this guy is roped in here so he can't come out. A lot of times you'll see this also with high angle rescue, utilizing Stokes baskets to lower and lift people up. Stair chair. This is everyone's worst nightmare for large patients or patients that are unresponsive. Obviously, is to get people up and downstairs. Newer stair chairs, they're heavy as shit and they are Bluetooth. Car accidents, rescue ops. We got Pompano on scene here. Assess the scene for hazards, right? What are we looking for? Down power lines. We're looking to see, is there anybody underneath the vehicle? Is there somebody been ejected? Are there multiple vehicles that we just don't see when we show up? Typically what we'll do is we call it inner outer. We have one person looking at an outside perimeter for any sort of hazards around the scene. Whoever's doing the inner circle is looking for anything inside the scene. Is there anyone inside the vehicle, airbags deployed, people restrained, people stuck, things of that sort. Always assess the scene for hazards. Multiple vehicles, call for additional resources. Pretty self-explanatory. If you don't call for additional resources, you're going to be kicking yourself later because then you're going to be a little overwhelmed. Do you suspect a hazmat incident when you do your size up? Again, if you do, where did I say you have to go? Back to the truck. Get out of there. Get any sort of bystander away from that incident. If there are people like hanging around and you're suspecting a hazmat, make sure people aren't just loitering, standing around. Changes in the scene, hazards, and the patients are your three priorities on this scene. Make sure you're monitoring the scene. Make sure you're monitoring for any additional hazards that are going to happen and patients. Again, people could get thrown. People could be under vehicles, things of that sort. We need to make sure that we check everything before we start initiating treatment. What I don't want to see is early on is this. Don't walk up to cars and just start touching things. Trust me, you're going to want to when you're there, especially if people are yelling and trying to get your attention. We need to assess the scene for hazards first. All right, I got a scenario here for you. You're on scene of a motor vehicle crash. Fire department just extricated a 37-year-old female from the vehicle, placed her on your stretcher. Awesome. As you're strapping the patient onto the backboard, an off-duty ER physician walks up to you and states, "This patient does not require a backboard. just apply a C-collar and go. Your protocols require a backboard for patients with neck and back pain. You originally decided to put this patient on a backboard because they were complaining of neck and back pain. Now this off-duty ER doctor is trying to tell you what to do. Now, are they technically higher level of care? I mean, yeah, if they're really a doctor, I don't know who the hell this guy is. Understand, you have protocols. This is your scene. Don't let people just walk in and tell you what to do. Understand, they're not responsible for that patient. You are. You're the one writing the report. You're the one transporting that patient to the hospital. So do not just take people's advice or whatever the case might be, unless that person is taking over that patient's care. Are they the one transporting? Are they coming with you to the hospital? Are they the one writing the report? Okay, be mindful of this. I've actually seen that happen before. People just show up and start saying stuff. It's like, hey, thank you so much for your time and your service, but we're going to be leaving now. Consent. All right. We got a couple different types of consent. Guys, we're almost done here. Consent refers to the patients with decision-making capacity. Patients that have decision-making capacity. Who is able to consent? First of all, they have to be of legal age. Okay. For here, 18 and older, right? They have to be 18 or older or emancipated, right? Now, every state has different emancipated rules. Are they married? Do they have children? Are they in the military? Whatever the case might be. But they have to be of a legal age and they have to be in the right mind to make medical care decisions. If you think that they are altered, they're unable to make decisions, right? Now let's talk about the first one, informed consent. Informed consent just means that the patient gives you voluntary consent after they've been told what's happening. Hey man, listen, sir, you can see in this photo, listen, sir, we think you're having a heart attack. We think you need to go to a cath lab. This is what we're going to be doing for you. The patient could say, yeah, no thanks. Can the patient do that? Yeah, of course they can. But after they are told what's going on, you have to tell them basically, hey, this is the benefit of getting treatment, or this is what can happen if no treatment happens. If once a patient is fully aware of what's going on, they are allowed to either give you consent to transport and treat, or they can refuse. But they have to meet that criteria. Are they of age and can they make sound medical decisions for themselves? Now, I'm sure you remember a term called express consent. Express consent is another form of informed consent. It's if the patient expresses that they want you to perform the task, right? You're like, hey, sir, I need to start a line. And they go like this. Okay. They didn't say, yes, please do. But they expressed that they're giving you consent. Awesome. Implied consent. All right. Implied consent just means that the patient is unable to express consent, right? It could mean that they're unresponsive. It could mean that they're altered. It could mean that they're intoxicated, whatever the case might be. They're unable to give you sound judgment. They're unable to make good decisions for themselves. So what do? We assume that they would have given us consent to treat and transport them. Okay. That's what implied consent is. We already said that the patient can refuse treatment. Absolutely. Real quick on start triage, we remember 32 can do. 30 means respirations greater than 30, right? 30 greater than 30, if they're a red tag, immediately red tag if their respirations are greater than 30. If my patient has a capillary refill greater than 2 seconds or no radial pulse, this patient is a red tag. If my patient is unable to follow commands, remember 30, two, can do. Can they follow commands? If they cannot follow commands, they are a red tag. Who is our priority? Red tags will always be our priority patient. Yellow tag just means that they're delayed. So they meet 32, they don't meet the criteria for 32 can do. They just can't move. They're delayed in treatment. Minor means that they're walking and they're able to get around. Obviously, black tag means no respirations at all after a head tilt chin lift. Patient is deceased. We're not going to perform CPR or positive pressure ventilations on adults. We're just going to provide head tilt chin lift, move on. But remember, who's our priority? Those red tags are. Ops, talking about CISD. CISD is critical incident stress debriefing. What is it? What CISD is there for is to diffuse psychological trauma for rescuers, right? Some of these guys, some of these girls, some of these responders see some crazy stuff. And some of these calls require us to talk about it. Okay. Most organizations, once they call or blow the whistle for CISD, we get teams of people that come in and want to discuss the call. What happened? What'd you guys do? Who did what? Talking about it does help. Is it mandatory? No. You can refuse. No, I'm cool, man. I'm tough. I'm going to go to my room, whatever. I'm going to tell you right now, it does work. Talk about it. If something really bothers you, talk to your crew. Get it off your chest. Disinfecting equipment. I'm sure you guys have been on ride times with fire departments. They disinfect, should be somewhat disinfecting trucks during checkout or on their first call a lot of organizations are cleaning off everything, especially with COVID going on now. You're going to see a lot of this going on, sprays that are in the back of the truck, spraying their gear, things of that sort. What if you see evidence of lice or bed bugs, like in the patient's hair, on the patient's clothing, things of that sort? This needs to be recorded and reported to your department. Typically, that truck needs to be put out of service and get professional cleaning. Is there any blood on the stretcher? All that stuff, or any of your equipment, all that stuff needs to be cleaned before and after every call. We're right here at the end, guys. Libel and slander. Libel means false statement that's in written form, okay? That injures somebody's good name, right? Even if in your patient care report, your electronic patient care report that you're writing on about this patient, if you put something in there that is your opinion, it's libel. Because guess what? Somebody can pull that report and it can be considered public information, right? Now, somebody sees what you wrote and it's your opinion about this patient or person. This can be technically against the law and held against you in court. So be mindful. We always want to be objective and just say what we see, obtain facts, things of that sort. Don't give your opinions. Slander is verbal. You're basically saying things. You don't know who the hell you're talking to. I'm telling you that right now. You could be given a report to the nurse at the hospital. You don't know who she is or he is and who they are in compared with the patient. If you start saying things that are not nice, again, your opinion, you could potentially get in trouble. Called slander, when you say things that are making somebody else look bad. Fake news. Community relations, this is a popular one. Helmets, fire departments with bicycle helmets with kids. Really popular community relations type thing. You might have a question on an exam where they talk about the fire department offers like a car seat installment in cars. What kind of task is this? Or what, I'm trying to think of the terminology, but it would be more of a community relations, public relations type thing within our service. I believe this is the last thing, talking about red bags. What are they for? Everyone here has seen them. What have you seen people throw in red bags? I bet you've seen everything. People probably throwing in damn soda cans in red bags. Understand, red bags are not trash cans. What goes in red bags is saturated blood. Okay. If I grab a gauze and I squeeze it and blood is dripping from that gauze, it's saturated in blood, that should be in a red bag. Everything else should not. Not vomit, not any other bodily fluid. This is a problem. All right, with a lot of agencies that pay lots of money to get rid of their red bags, understand that saturated blood is what is supposed to be inside of those red bags. We did it.